Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
St. Anthony of Patmos Parish family welcomes all who have gathered our liturgy in the 25th Sunday of ordinary time. Join with us as we lift our voices in praise and thanksgiving to our Almighty Father. We are kindly requested at this time to turn off all electronic devices, including cell phones. This liturgy is being offered for the happy repose of the soul of Vincenzo Liaga on the 5th anniversary of his passing. A reminder that all hymns, prayers, and readings for today's Mass can be found in the bulletin. Let us begin our prayer by joining in singing, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God Almighty. Please stand.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Wrapped up by keeping your precepts, we may merit to attain eternal life. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way, and the wicked their thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy. For our God, who is generous and forgiving, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, life is Christ, and death is gain. If I go on living in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. And if I do not know which I shall choose, I am caught between the two. I long to depart this life and be with Christ, for that is far better. Yet I remain in the flesh is more necessary for your benefit. Only conduct yourselves in a way worthy of the gospel of Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Jesus told his disciples this parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out at dawn to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with them for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. Going out about 9 o'clock, the landowner saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You too, go into my vineyard, and I will give you what is just." So they went off. And he went out again around noon and around 3 o'clock and did likewise. Going out about 5 o'clock, the landowner found others standing around and said to them, "Why do you stand here idle all day?" They answered, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You too, go into my vineyard." When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Summon the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and ending with the first." And those who had started about 5 o'clock came, each received the usual daily wage. So when the first came, they thought that they would receive more. But each of them also got the usual wage. And on receiving it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last ones worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who bore the day's burden and the heat." He said to one of them in reply, "My friend, I am not cheating you. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what is yours and go. What if I wish to give these last one the same as you? Or am I not free to do as I wish with my own money? Are you envious because I am generous?" Thus, the last will be first, and the first will be last. The Gospel of the Lord.
I didn't deserve that. I didn't deserve that. How many times in our life have we uttered these very words? I didn't deserve that. We say that as children when we get a punishment that seems too harsh. We say that when we're in school every time we get an essay or a term paper that comes back with a lower grade than we wanted. We certainly say that when we're cut from a team or when we're called out on strikes when a pitch was really close, or when we were called for a penalty on a pass play, when contact in our mind was only minimal. We probably say that when we were dumped by a girlfriend or a boyfriend. We say that when we get a bad performance review at work, or when we get a ticket for only going 5 miles over the speed limit, or when we were dealt some insensitive words at the mouth of our spouse. And certainly, and understandably, we say that when we come down with a really serious illness. I didn't deserve that. I didn't deserve that. You know, this is always used by us in a purely negative sense when things don't go the way that we hope. But wait. God forgives us, then. God forgives us, and then what? What do we say then? I deserve it? Think about that. The story that we heard from the Gospel of Matthew is familiar to all of us. It's an easy story to remember, primarily for one simple reason. Because the landowner acts in a way that's completely opposite on how we almost certainly would act in a similar situation. The story, in a certain sense, is meant to not really make sense to us, but it's meant to make us take pause and try to figure out what Jesus is trying to tell us through this story. And of course, as most passages in Scripture go, there's not just one specific meaning that we could give to this passage and glean from this text? We could say, for example, that we might see this story as encouraging us not to resent others who have had a late life conversion, or who have all of a sudden seemed to have gotten on board with Christianity after a lifetime of bad behavior. Or we might see this text as to not trying to play God, reminding us to leave judging to God alone. Or we might see this story as being grateful for blessings that God provides for others. You know, all of these are wonderful thoughts. All of these could be subject for discussion on this particular text. But all of these presume the same thing. Did you catch what that was in these examples? Can you guess what all of those things I just said have in common? What they have in common is they basically all exhibit the thing we do often when we hear Jesus tell us challenging parables. In this case, every interpretation that I've used as an example above presumes that we are the faithful ones. It presumes that we are the ones who give God a full day's work. It presumes that it's the other people who aren't. Other people are coming up short. Other people are being paid more than they deserve. And that we somehow have to be okay with it. Is that what's really going on here? Probably not. You see, if after hearing the story, we only see ourselves as the ones who worked all day and therefore deserve more, then we're really in a dangerous place spiritually, a place in which we are not the problem, that we are doing it all right, that we are always pleasing to God, and that we know in our hearts that this couldn't be further from the truth. If we're honest, we aren't the ones who always give God a full day's work. We're the ones who only give God a little effort, a little work, a little time, a little bit of ourselves. We are the people who don't always love unconditionally. We are the people who aren't always generous. We are the people who are always moved with mercy and compassion, simply because we are all sinners. We are all flawed people, often unwilling to embrace the lives that God is inviting us to. And that means that we are the ones who don't deserve what God is willing and anxious to provide. We are the ones who should be hoping not to get what we deserve in the most positive sense of that phrase. And that sort of humility and that sort of honesty can lead us to be only one thing, and that is grateful. Because a faith-filled heart is a grateful heart. And may we never resent the blessings that God showers upon others. May we never try to judge another person's relationship with God. And most importantly, may we never forget and always be thankful for God's unwillingness to give us what we truly deserve. God gives us so much. Remember that line from the Gospel? Are we envious because God is generous? Not if we're honestly looking at ourselves. Envious? No. Grateful? Always. What a tremendous God we have. Together, brothers, let us pray. I believe in one another, Father, one another, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages. God of God, life of life, true God and true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, so the Lord of the Lord, and he came in heaven. For our sake, he was crucified in Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We know that God is near to all who call upon him. We turn now to our generous God with our prayers and with our needs.
That the Pope, bishops, priests, and deacons will be signs of God's living presence among us as they preach the gospel. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For government officials on the national, state, and local levels, that they may govern with humility and ensure the rights of all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may look upon the poor, the vulnerable, the stranger, and the unborn with the unconditional love and welcome portrayed by the gospel. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For catechists, may they be blessed with creativity and enthusiasm as stewards of God's gifts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are suffering from natural disasters, that God will ease their pain, fill their hearts with hope, and bring the assistance to them that they need. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people who perish, that God may continue to bless us, to keep us, and help us to grow together as one parish family. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the sick, the poor, and the lonely may find the consolation of God's presence and the love of his people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who died, especially Vincenzo Biotti, and our recently deceased Father Frank Kimar, MSC, that they may find joy and honor as they enter into eternal peace with the righteous. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all the intentions we hold close to our hearts. Pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And now we conclude the prayer of our lives by heaven. Most merciful and kind God, we come to you in our weakness, we come to you in our fear. We come to you in trust, for you alone are our hope. We place before you the disease present in our world, and we turn to you in time of need. Bring wisdom to doctors, give understanding to scientists. Endow caregivers with compassion and generosity. Bring healing to those who are ill, protect those most at risk. Give comfort to those who have lost a loved one. Welcome those who have died into your eternal home. Stabilize our communities. Unite us in our compassion. Remove all fear from our hearts. Fill us with confidence in your faith. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Thank you.
desperate devotion of faith may be there to remember heavenly mysteries through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up your hearts, O Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his work he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state. By his suffering canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the gates to eternal life. And by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, in the company of the angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acknowledge. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Albert, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them to the life of your thanks. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Bread given with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Give
peace in our lives, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I give you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Those who are unable to be with us today, for those who are unable to receive our Holy Eucharist at this time, I would like now to pray the prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and I unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
Integrity.
Rejoicing in the gift of the Eucharist, we join in singing, "Here I Am, Lord."